I just love this verse.
Thank you.
Oh, is that the 2 minutes? I guess. I think so. That's great. Yeah. Yep, there you go. Good stuff. I trust you're living on the hallelujah side this morning. You know, we can say hallelujah no matter what. It isn't based on how we feel. I get a little bit of a ring here, a little bit of an extra overtone. We can shout hallelujah anytime. And I think of Paul and Silas when they were falsely accused of starting a riot, were flogged against the law, thrown in prison in the inner cell. Now this is where nobody cleans out the rats or any of the feces or urine of the prisoners before. And they're in there having a big pity party, aren't they? No. Just complaining and griping. They weren't either.
No, they weren't.
They were living on the hallelujah side. They were singing praises to God. And I'll tell you, God rocked that place, didn't he? Hey? The house was rocking. Absolutely. That earthquake hit, blew the doors open. And God wants to hear your praise. And your soul, your spirit needs to praise. It was made to praise.
Let all that is within me
bless the Lord. Amen. And especially if things aren't going your way. Especially if you have been somehow mistreated, done wrong, dealt a raw deal, shall we say. You know what? Even then, and especially then, as Paul and Silas did, we can praise the Lord. Those of you who are inside, you can stand with me as we sing. This is one of the camp songs too. No, not one. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. If you want to stand with me, let's do that. If you want to sit, that's fine too. Let's sing this song together. We're going to get this one moving a little bit. Here we go.
There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. None else could heal all our souls' diseases. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. No friend like him is so high and holy. No, not one. No, not one. And yet no friend is so meek and lowly. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about my struggles. He will Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. There's not an hour that he does not hear us. No, not one. No, not one. No night so dark but his love can cheer us. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. Now never saint find his friend, forsake him. No, not one. No, not one. Or sinner find that he would not take him. No, not one. No, not one. Jesus knows struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the lowly Jesus. No, not one. No, not one. More verse. Was there a gift like the Savior given? No, not one. No, not one. Will he refuse us a home in heaven? No, not. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a
says, thank you, praise you. For even though you are high and holy, oh, you're also meek and lowly. You don't refuse anybody. You want everybody to draw close to you. And we want to choose that today as well, to draw close to you, to realize just how much you love us, how much you desire for us to have your life spilling up, flowing, bubbling up in a river of life flowing out of us. Thank you, Jesus, for this day. Thank you for this opportunity you've given us to be together. And we ask for your sweet presence by your Spirit to move, to help, to change, to renew us. Accept the praises we bring. We pray in your holy name. Amen. Amen. We're going to be focusing on the cross today. And a little bit later, I'm going to be preaching on the significance of the cross. And I thought, what better way to help us to focus on that than to sing about the cross? And there's one song that, well, people think, well, this is for a funeral. Well, it's not. It's not for a funeral. It's for any time. The old rugged cross. And it's been a long time since I've sung this one. And but I want you to hear the words and just let the words really soak into your soul today as we sing this together.
Yeah.
the old rugged cross, till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday.
May be seated, please. I mentioned yesterday to someone that the only man-made things in heaven are the scars on Jesus' body. And what a wonderful, awesome testimony to his love for us. Let's sing this next song together. I think you'll know it. Jesus, keep me near the cross. And we focus on him.
Jesus, keep me
leave those words up there for a moment. I just had a flash of my surveying days. Back 30-some years ago, when I look through the transit, the surveyor's transit, what's in there? But they call them crosshairs. Crosshairs are there so you can tell when something is exactly straight up and down or exactly straight across. And I saw this verse, help me walk from day to day with its shadow or me. I think, you know what? That's like the crosshairs. It gives you a straight line. The cross is able to, when you focus on the cross, it's able to keep you from running into one ditch or another, isn't it? Tell them, no, when your life is being lived where God is pleased. That verse kind of struck me this morning as I thought about back in those surveying days and trying to, you know, run straight lines 5 miles through the bush, you know, and with, what did we have? Black flies, deer flies, horse flies, elephant flies too we had back there. They were huge up in northern Ontario. But anyway, you're running a line 5 miles through the bush and you can't be off at the end of that 5 miles by 6 inches. Otherwise, you got to go right back and do it all over again. And that to me is the cross. Hey, when I survey the wondrous cross. We might even sing that one a little bit later. Let's go on. Where were we? Near the cross, I'll watch and wait. Let's go to that verse. Next verse.
Near the cross, I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting, and
Just a couple of announcements. We can celebrate together. Amen. Let's just sing our next song before the throne of God above, and maybe just after that we'll just have a word of prayer, and then Wayne, you'll come up and minister in song to us. That'd be wonderful.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is Love, whoever lives and spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased with his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. I bow before the cross of Christ and marvel at this love divine. God's perfect Son was sacrificed to make my interest in God's eyes. This river's depth I cannot know, but
Father, we thank you and praise you for this river flow of your grace and your love that has been poured out. Father, the thought struck me this week again. I just don't know what people do without you. When they bump up against the tough stuff in their life, when they come up against the unanswerable question, when they hit the rough patch, and oh, Father, thank you. Thank you that you are there no matter what. You don't walk away when we've made a mistake. You don't walk away when we've fallen flat on our face. You don't walk away when we've chosen sin instead of you. Just stand there inviting us to stand up, to line up with the shadow of the cross again and keep walking. Oh, Father, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for his sacrifice for us. And thank you for the fact that we can breathe out to you a prayer at any moment in time. Whether it's a prayer of thanksgiving and praise, or if it's just a simple ask of something that most people would think would be silly, too small to bother you with, and everything in between. And so, Father, you've heard the concerns in our hearts today. For those individuals who need your comfort, your peace, the hope of Jesus Christ in their lives, healing touch, the renewal of body and maybe spirit and even mind. And Lord, there are others on our hearts this morning that we haven't spoken out loud, but Some of them they're kind of weighing on our hearts and minds. They're a burden to us. And we carry them out of a weight of concern, not necessarily out of not wanting to turn them over to you, but just because, Lord, it's a weight in our hearts. It's a concern, a deep felt concern. And so we lift them up to you. We think of little Alexander. Oh, Father, we pray for him. We ask, Father, your special hand of touch on him. You love the little children. And when the disciples were trying to chase them away, you said, no, no, no. No, don't do that. Let the little children come to me. Because to them belongs the kingdom of heaven. So we pray for little Alexander. We pray for his mom and dad too. That they would feel you close. That they would realize that you love them too. And they would reach out in faith toward you. Pray for little David Vanessen, who is still going through this cancer treatment. 2.5 years old. Oh, what a journey. Pray for his mom and dad and brothers and sisters and the entire family. That you would draw them to yourself. Give them the strength where they feel like they've maybe reached the end of their resources. Renew their strength. Renew their hope. And help this little David fella to realize that you are so close to him. Father, I think sometimes children that young, they can see you when you are in the room. I think they can see the angels when they're in the room and they wonder why nobody else can. I just have that feeling that happens sometimes. And so, Jesus, would you be in that room with both these little fellas, Alexander and with David and others that we know. Oh, watch over them, Lord. Keep them in your peace and your love and your care. And may we also stay close. Oh, close to the cross. Thank you that the ground at the foot of the cross is level. Nobody's higher than anybody else. It's all the same level. Just help us to get in close and to hang on tight. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Wayne, would you come and minister in song, please?
This song, I guess I should take this off, but Mike, where it's supposed to be. This song is a favorite of mine ever since I first found it. And it's a good one for communion. It talks about some of the blessings that we have in Jesus Christ because of his death, what is offered to us who put our faith and trust in him. As I was communing with the Lord yesterday, he directed me to 1 Peter chapter 2 and felt that that should be part of what is given this morning. And I wasn't really sure I could see how it fit in. But you were directed by the Spirit too, talking about Paul and Silas. Jesus Christ told us that if we were going to follow him, we needed to take up our cross and follow him. Mm-hmm. And 2 Peter 2, starting verse 21, says, "You have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow in his steps." One of the blessings that we have is to suffer with Christ and for Christ. And that's just diametrically opposed to the world and to what our natural minds might think. Yeah, that's right. But we're called to suffer with Christ, who committed no sin, nor was any deceit found in his mouth. And while being reviled, he did not revile in return. While suffering, he uttered no threats, but kept entrusting himself to him who judges righteously. We're living in a time, and it's going to get worse, where as you stand for Jesus Christ, people are going to think you're nuts. You're crazy. And they're going to revile you and ridicule you. But we don't do it back in return. No, we trust the one who judges righteously. And he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. For by his wounds you were healed. Praise God. It's called a song. The song is called Hallowed Be the Name.
Forgot all about the kids going down, but we're good to go. Yeah, all right. Melissa is going to take children downstairs for children's church. Thank you, Wayne, for sharing that so fitting today as we think about what Jesus did for us on the cross. Years ago, I was in a donut shop in Smiths Falls. And the young lady behind the counter serving me was wearing a necklace with a cross on it. And I commented on how nice it looked and then asked her, "What does it mean to you?" "Oh," she said, "a friend gave it to me when I was in the hospital and I started getting better that day. So it's kind of like a good luck charm." Well, if I had had the time, I would have asked her if I could have shared with her what the cross means to me. That's kind of the second step of being able to bridge that gap. So what does the cross mean? Now, we've got a rustic barnwood cross back behind me here. People wear crosses as necklaces, rings, earrings, even tattoos. Crosses show up on Bible covers and stickers on their car windows, wall hangings, monuments. The symbol of the cross is everywhere. We are so familiar with this symbol that we sometimes forget that it was introduced by the Romans as a torturous means of execution. Can you imagine having a noose hanging on the wall behind me here? Or how about a row of 6 or 8 rifles? Kind of puts it in a different light, doesn't it? What does the cross mean? We're going to answer that question in a minute, but for now, let me ask you another question, a more personal one. What does the cross mean to you? I'm not going to ask you to answer. I'm going to actually ask you to answer that question a little bit later. And if you want to jot it down somewhere and just have it ready for near the end of the message, what does the cross mean to you? John 12, verses 20 to 23 is an interesting passage here. It says, "Now there were some Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the feast," that is, the feast of Passover, "and these men came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and began to ask him, saying, 'Sir, we wish to see Jesus.' Philip came and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip came and told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, 'The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified.'" Now, let's get a little bit of an understanding of the setting here, okay? A few weeks before this, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. That news spread like wildfire all over the country. Why? Because Jesus had raised someone on the fourth day after they were dead, and Jews believed that a spirit would only hang around a body for 3 days and then would go to paradise. But Jesus did it on the fourth day. And Jews had developed a belief that only the Messiah would be able to raise a person on the fourth day or later. And so, was this really then the Messiah? If you turn back with me to John 11, one chapter back, verse 45, it says there, "Therefore, many of the Jews who came to Mary and saw what he had done," this is after the resurrection of Lazarus, "believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them the things which Jesus had done. Therefore, the chief priests and the Pharisees convened a council and were saying, 'What are we doing? For this man is performing many signs,'" the signs of what they could recognize the Messiah as. All right? "And what if we let him go on like this, all men will believe in him. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you take into account that it is expedient for you that one man die for the people, and that the whole nation not perish." Now, he did not say this on his own initiative, but being the high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus was going to die for the nation. "And not for the nation only, but in order that he might also gather together into one the children of God who were scattered abroad." So from that day on, they planned together to kill him. "Therefore, Jesus no longer continued to walk publicly among the Jews, but went away from there to the country near the wilderness, into a city called Ephraim, and there he stayed with the disciples." Now, the Passover of the Jews was near. So this is where we read just a moment ago where the Greeks said, "Hey, we want to meet this Jesus guy." Now, the Passover of the Jews was near, and many went up to Jerusalem out of the country before the Passover to purify themselves. So they were seeking for Jesus. You see, they wanted to see this guy who had raised Lazarus from the dead on the fourth day. And they were saying to one another as they stood in the temple, "What do you think? That he will not come to the feast at all?" Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was to report it so they might seize him. Then, on the Sunday before the Passover, Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey to the shouts and cheers of literally thousands of people. If you can picture with me Jerusalem, the city over here, and then a big valley, the Kidron Valley, and the Mount of Olives over here. The Mount of Olives had tens of thousands of people camping out on the on that mount. They were in Jerusalem for the Passover to worship at the temple. And I mean, they didn't have enough hotel rooms back then, guys. Okay? They had to camp out under the trees, under the stars, in a tent, whatever it was. And so they were there. And these Greeks that we read about in chapter 12 were pagans, but had come to Jerusalem to worship Jehovah, the God of Israel. They were seekers. And they saw something in this Jewish faith that stirred them, that told them there was truth in this one God theology. Because you see, as Greeks, they would have grown up with 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 gods. Gods for just about anything and everything you could imagine. But the Jewish faith said there was one God. And they were there to try and learn, discover what this was all about. And they had heard about this Jesus. Somehow they had heard about this man who had performed miracles, taught with authority, and raised someone after 4 days from the dead. Maybe they had even been in the crowd watching Jesus' spectacular entry into the city of Jerusalem. Now they wanted to see him, to meet him for themselves, to evaluate him and see what others were saying about him, if it was true or not. So when the disciples brought these Greeks, these Gentiles, to Jesus, he told them about the cross, his death, the end of his earthly ministry. Isn't that weird? That's just kind of weird. Jesus answered them, John 12:23, and saying, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. He who loves his life loses it. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it to eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. Now, my soul has become troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth," that's the reference to the cross, "will draw everyone to myself." But he was saying this to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die. Wow. Apparently, Jesus considered his crucifixion the most significant fact to tell these Greek seekers. And the same is true for any person who would try to evaluate or meet Jesus. If you want to see Jesus, if you want to understand him, it has to be through the cross. The only ground on which these Greeks could approach Jesus, could understand him, could share in his work, was through the cross. But Jesus came first and foremost for the Jews. He said that a number of times. The Gentiles, non-Jews, were still excluded from the commonwealth of Israel. Strangers to the covenants of the promise, having no hope and without God in the world. The gospel, which means good news of salvation, only came to the Gentiles, the Greeks, through the blood of the cross. The ultimate victory of the cross was being pointed to by these Greeks coming to Jesus ahead of time. They represented the masses from the nations of the world who would eventually believe. Comparatively, only a few Jews believed in Jesus as their Messiah, whereas countless millions of Gentiles since then, you and I included, have believed on him for salvation from our sin. Jesus pointed to these Greeks, to the significance of the cross. And let's first look at the significance of the cross in the Bible. From beginning to end, the Bible is essentially a record of the cross. If you try to take the cross out of the Bible, it would be like pulling a thread used to sew two pieces of cloth together. They'd just fall apart. The Old Testament points forward to the cross. The Gospels are all about the journey to the cross, and the rest of the New Testament points back to the cross. The significance of the cross in the Bible, as it's foreshadowed in the law, is this. You know that even before the law was given to Moses, God had decreed that blood had to be shed to cover sin and deal with His anger against sin. Sin had killed the life that God had placed within us, and God's righteous judgment for that was death. But instead of placing that penalty on every single individual who sinned, which was everybody, God provided a symbol of death, of a death sentence through the spilling of the blood of a sacrificial animal. But just here, there's a huge problem. The blood of an animal could only symbolize what was needed. It couldn't deal with human sin. The blood of an animal couldn't deal with the need to have our guilt taken away and the stain of our sin washed out. Hebrews 10 helps us understand this. It says in Hebrews 10, 1-4, for the law, since it has only a shadow of the good things to come, not the very form of things, can never, by the same sacrifices which they offer continually year by year, make perfect those who draw near. Otherwise, would they not have ceased to be offered? Because the worshippers, having once been cleansed, would no longer have had consciousness of sin. But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins year by year. Every year, an animal was sacrificed, blood was shed and spilled and sprinkled. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. An animal can't be substitute for a human. Every priest, the writer of Hebrews goes on to say in verse 11, stands daily ministering and offering time after time the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But he, who's he? Jesus. Having offered one sacrifice for sins for all time, sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time onward until the enemies be made a footstool for his feet. For by one offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. The law was only a shadow of the good things to come of the cross. And next we see the significance of the cross in the prophets. I know that the prophets show up only in the Old Testament, but we really get an understanding of what they saw. In order to do that, we need to look at a New Testament passage, 1 Peter chapter 1, starting at verse 10, where Peter says, when these prophets were writing as to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful searches and inquiries, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. Peter is saying that the prophets who wrote hundreds of years before, anywhere from 300-400 years to 800 years before, caught glimpses of a time coming in the future of a suffering Messiah, of something that would happen in glory that was beyond what they could comprehend, but they kind of tried to figure it out. Verse 12, it was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. Peter is now saying, you folks who are living today in these things which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. Things into which angels long to look. Not even angels can fully comprehend God's grace. They're perfect. They don't need grace. We're the ones who need it. So, how significant was the cross in the gospels? We've had the law, the prophets, the gospels. Well, one quarter of the Gospels, 25% of the first four books of the New Testament, is written about the journey to and death of Jesus on the cross. Many times Jesus talked about his own crucifixion long before it happened. You take the cross of the Gospels and you have no good news. Just news. News that a good and right living teacher met an untimely end. That's all you've got. But what about the cross, significance of the cross in the early church? That's the rest of the New Testament. Well, turn with me to 1 Corinthians, if you would. The verses will come up on the screen. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22 and following. For indeed, Jews ask for signs and Greeks search for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To Jews, a stumbling block, and to Gentiles, foolishness. But to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. And then in chapter 2 of this same book, and when I came to you, Paul is saying, I did not come with superiority of speech or of wisdom proclaiming to you the testimony of God. For I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And again in 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also died for sins once for all, the just for the unjust, so that He might bring us to God, having been put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit. You see, you can't take the cross out of that early church. It's all about the cross. In the 90 to 110 years after Christ's death and resurrection, in which the New Testament was written without the cross, there are no people freed from sin. There are no people released from the grip of Satan. There are no transformed lives. There is no missionary effort. There is no church planting. Folks, there's no church. Period. So we've taken a quick look at the significance of the cross in the Bible. Secondly, let's take a quick look at the significance of the cross in Christian experience. There are three phases of the cross in the full Christian experience. No more, no less. The first one is salvation. In 1 Peter 2:24, brother, you read this verse earlier. For He Himself bore our sins in His body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. That's salvation. And if in order for anyone to experience salvation, that is to be saved from an eternal destiny of punishment for their sin in hell, they must believe and accept that what Jesus went through on the cross was for them. That they deserve to die because of their own sin and sinfulness and resulting rebellion against God. The other day I told somebody, you know what? There are no good people in heaven. Every one of them was a sinner. Mm-hmm. That's right. Well, yeah. There's not going to be a single non-sinner in heaven except for Jesus. He is the only perfect one. Salvation means believing that Jesus took it all on Himself and died in your place. Have you believed it? Have you accepted it? That's what it means to be saved from your sin. The second part of the cross in Christian experience is sanctification. Sanctification really just means being set apart. That's what it is, for holy purposes. Okay? It's a big long word, but it's not too complicated. I think I can think of no better way to tell you what sanctification is than read what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans 6, where he says, "What shall we say then? Are we to continue to sin so that grace may increase? Because, hey, wherever sin is, grace is there more." So Paul says, what do you think? You're supposed to go on, keep more and more sins, you get more and more grace? He says, no way! That's not the way. It may never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it? That's part of sanctification, dying to sin. Let's keep going, verse 3. Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into His death? Therefore, we have been buried with Him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. That's another part of sanctification, walking in newness of life. Let's keep going. Verse 5. For if we have become united with Him in the likeness of His death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with Him, in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we no longer be slaves to sin. Sanctification? Our old self crucified. No longer slaves to this inward compulsion to sin. Verse 8. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe we shall also live with Him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer has mastery over Him. For the death that He died to sin once for all, but the life that he lives to God. Now here's the next part of sanctification, verse 11. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. That's the faith part of sanctification. Now here comes the action part. Remember the faith part? Even so, consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God. That's faith. That's here. Now here's the action part of sanctification in verse 12. Actually, yeah. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts or desires. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as alive from the dead and your members of as instruments of righteousness to God. Sanctification. The crucified, risen life of Jesus Christ, living in the believer by faith so that sin and self are crucified and the command to be holy is followed and lived out day by day. The third principle represented by the cross in Christian experience is this: self-denying service. Brother Wayne, I just love, I just love what God does when He puts together a Sunday morning. I just love it. Self-denying service. In the Bible passage we started off with, Jesus said, "He who loves his life loses it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it to eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me." Elsewhere, Jesus said, "If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." And in 1 John 3:16, we read this: "We know love by this, that he," Jesus, "laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for others." Now, what I'm going to say next, some of you may get offended at, but you know what? That's not my problem. That's for you to take up with the Holy Spirit and to work it out. If your Christianity has not changed your attitude to others, has never moved you with compassion to help someone else in some kind of need, if all you can think about is yourself and doing the best you can until you get to heaven, then you had better seriously question whether or not you're even going to end up there. Let me just give you the words to fill in the rest of this, the significance of the cross in history. Reconciliation of God and mankind. B, redemption of the church. And C, renewal of the world. I don't have enough time to unpack those, but let's go back to the original. Leave that screen up just for a little while, if you would. So if people are taking notes here, they can get that. Reconciliation, redemption, and renewal. Let's go back to that original question that I asked you to write down an answer on for. What does the cross mean to me? Let me hear some responses.
It's an anchor.
An anchor?
Forgiveness.
Hope.
My ticket into heaven.
Your ticket into heaven? What else?
Guidance.
Love.
Refreshed.
Teaching.
Grace.
Compassion. All of the above. I like that. That's good too.
Redemption.
Amen.
It's a reminder of what's to come.
A reminder of what's even to come. Yeah.
Sacrifice.
Yeah. Maybe some of these responses sound strange to you. Maybe some of them even sound inviting. Maybe you wish you could experience what others are describing. The passion, the intensity, the freedom. If that's the case, ask God for it. Tell Him that you want what others are describing, then give me a call. I'd love to sit down with you and unpack all that it could mean for you today and for eternity. And maybe all of this has just encouraged your heart and renewed your sense of faith. Tell it to God. Let Him know how much you love Him because He has loved you first. And as you take communion, may it be just from the depths of your soul a way to praise God for the cross and for Jesus. Amen. Amen. When the bells are done ringing, we're going to sing the song, "The Wonderful Cross." It is the song, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," with the refrain in there that someone has written for us to sing. And so By the way, if you didn't know, those bells are ringing in support of frontline workers and have been rung every Sunday at noon for well over a year now. And they're going to continue to ring until this whole COVID pandemic is kind of, the dust has settled from it. And so it's a neat way of Wilton just trying to pay tribute and honor to those who've really, and pray for health, our healthcare workers. I was again, I was listening to a bit of a documentary on the burnout that's happening.
Yes.
And the crisis that's beginning to happen within our healthcare system of the of what's happening. Wayne, did you have?
Yeah, I just wanted to kind of carry on with the thought that I talked about before, that the blessings of the cross,
yes,
in suffering with Christ.
Mm.
We're saying, I'll cherish the overwhelming cross and exchange it someday for
a crown.
You know, it's an investment.
Yes.
When we suffer for Christ.
Amen.
That's why the early disciples counted it all joy to suffer, yes, with Christ. That they were worthy to suffer,
yes,
with Christ. It's a,
amen,
blessed thing to walk in His footsteps.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah. We have to follow in His steps. That's right. If you're able, let's stand together to sing this song as we prepare for communion.
When I serve.
See from His head.
See from His head, His hands, His feet. Sorrow and love flow mingled down. Dear, such love and soul.
Corinthians 11 says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread or and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But each one must examine himself, and in so doing they are to eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For the one who eats and drinks judgment on himself if they do not judge the body rightly. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord so that we will not be condemned along with the world. Would you take a moment just in this quiet to bring your heart to the Father and examine your own heart? Ask him to show you if there's anything that needs to be dealt with between you and him, you and someone else, and then offer it up to him. Ask for his forgiveness and commit to reconciliation so that we can receive these elements together. Father, thank you for the cross. Praise you for the cross and all that it means. May we not forget, ever forget, what you did for us there. Lord Jesus, the sacrifice that you made. You didn't deserve to die. You were perfect. But you took that place and took our sin. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Can we just sing maybe the first verse and chorus of that song? I come to the cross. I just feel there's a holy moment here that God wants us to be part of. And this song is a song of invitation for us to come to the cross as we prepare to take these elements. I come to the cross. Do we have the words to that one? The last song? I come to the cross. The next one. Yeah, there. Let's sing this.
I come to the cross, seeking mercy and grace. I come to the cross, where you died in my place. Out of my weakness and into your strength, humbly I come to the
brothers and sisters, the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Feed upon him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. The blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, for the forgiveness of your sin. Preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this remembering all that Jesus did for you. Amen. Can we do that second verse then, maybe? Let's sing that second verse in the chorus of that song, I Come to the Cross.
I come to the cross, needing cleansing from sin. I come to the cross to be made right within. Jesus, now wash me and I will be clean.
call me by name. You welcome this child that was lost. You paid the price for my guilt and my shame. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come to the cross.
You can love because he first loved you. So love him. Love each other. And then go out there and be the church. Amen.